Es el timbre de mis sueños, porque internamente creo que no hay dueños. Opaco es el perfil de tu mirada. Puedo ser.
I met Swiss artist Angela Lyn through my blog. She invited me to her show in London 3 years ago, and I couldn't attend because that same day I was checking into rehab for my drug addiction. But there's something that caught my attention, and somehow we became friends. At the time, I was working in the contemporary art world, and I understood art through names, brands, right galleries, that kind of post-minimalistic, commodified art objects that we can see in Frieze Art Fair, in the graduate shows. But there was something that asked in her work, that asked to be looked at closely and at a different pace. It asked for a different kind of attention, and it was that kind of change that I was ready to embark in my life, in what we can consider my midlife crisis. There was something about her art that had to do with giving the viewer a different place and a different pace. And it doesn't come as a surprise that recently, in this over-commercialized art world that considers youth as God, at the highest institutional level there are these artists that are claiming presence, or that are claiming that art should achieve a certain human connection, and where the artist and the viewer must become present. And on one extreme of this list, we can have someone like Marina Abramović, who transformed the presence of the artist into a commercial cliché and reached superstar status. And on the other side, we had, and we analyzed it in the Pill, both Marina Abramović and this one, Ligia Clark, at MoMA, we have someone like her who claimed a completely different new kind of participation for the viewers, that now MoMA is transforming, commercialized into a sort of, or a psychotherapy of sorts. But what caught my attention is that, and what is interesting for us, for our discussion, is that all of these efforts, including Angela Lyn and others that we're going to discuss in the future, are women in their over 50 years old. So we're talking about people with life experience. And somehow the public is demanding that kind of connection. But somehow the market doesn't know how to get to that. And I think it's the mission, if you want, it's the goal of the Pill, to explore this aspect. So I hope you enjoyed, and here we go with my first one-to-one interview with Angela Lyn. Shall we start?
The fact that I am a mother did have an effect on my choices artistically, and I think that the interest in, you know, in the next generation is just there, intrinsically, naturally. So, and one of the things I see, I just see that just from experience, from the generation of my children, is that one of the first things they look at is, are you a flake? Are you a flake? Are you present? Are you wheeling off a quick do? Is there anything behind it? And what is there behind it? So my response to that is fairly simple within the possibilities. I keep it simple. Maybe I am a fairly simple person, but it's taking time and a lot of presence in the actual process of painting that makes painting interesting in this day and age. In the 80s it was interesting because it was a time where you had a strange mixture. You had a great heaving sort of effort to churn out human emotion, or a sort of almost caricature of human emotion and energy, and churn it out fast and lush and gushy, but produce it and reproduce it. So there were, I mean, the colleagues I had in the 80s, people.
So we're talking about the new image, the new expressionism, a German expressionism.
Right.
Okay.
That was the junge Wilden, the junge Wilden in the 80s, Rainer Fetting, these people. And I remember some of these, they emerged very quickly. It was the beginning of really engineering artists and sort of pushing into value positions, pushing them into art institutions where they had to produce large works quickly. And of course, I think the first initial energy of this was very raw, of this work in the 80s. It wasn't an energized time. But it was the beginning of hardcore consumerism as well, and, you know, sucking up artists and saying, we can make something on this.
Yeah.
And I remember it was a very painful time. My memory of that time is being extremely painful, because I think, oddly enough, as a young artist, the thing you trust the most is your drive, because it's existential, and you probably know that that's how you can survive. And the art market started to completely counteract that. So if you got in, I remember I was showing with a good gallery in Zurich, and she took me to Art Basel and had some good critics in the paper and so on. But it clearly became...
Which year is this?
84. It came clear that once you sort of started to get into a success with a certain type of work, that's where you were supposed to stay, and you were supposed to manifest that then as a sort of product.
Okay, just to clarify and to summarize what you're saying that the kind of embrace of pictorialism and of expression through painting pushed artists to be so present in the canvas, so present in, so to express so much pain and so much of themselves, that encountered the logic of the art market and it became commodified. And there's no way of sustaining that without going crazy, turning into drugs, or killing yourself.
Yeah, you got it.
You're with us.
How
did you manage to survive that?
Because I had... also three children that, you know, I have several colleagues who did kill themselves. And
so being a woman, being a functional woman, saved you.
Yes, it did. And finally, in one way, it was banning me from certain things. I had galleries that were horrified when I announced my third pregnancy, that, you know, well, then I can't really be an artist. And
right.
And... so yes, sustainability.
So we would say that, I mean, yeah, because it's I'm starting to understand the idea of sustainability in terms of that kind of, in a way, in the experience that you're describing, feminism as the gains of women through the 50s and 60s would have ended up badly for someone like you.
Yeah, that's another big discussion. Director of the museum of the town where I was living at that time, and he got so emotionally charged one time when he came for a studio visit. He said, "Das ist Hausfrauen erotik. It's housewives erotic what you're doing," and. And I was sort of quite baffled, and he was very upset. I'd upset him. I was still today wondering why he got so upset. But I think it was a kind of energy that is human, so it got through to him. Mm-hmm. At the same time, it didn't fit in with a certain argument that he was trying to erect.
Right.
A certain argument pertaining to distance, to removal of any human presence or warmth. Another.
So you got too close.
Yeah, I got too close, and I, of course, as a young artist, I had no idea. I was sort of like a boat at sea. I didn't really know exactly. I wasn't conscious yet.
But I could see.
Another incident I had that was sort of really also a milestone for me, milestone moment that made me reflect. And I was one of the directors of the museums who had been, I've had a few fantastic angels along the way that have kept me really going, and this guy, he was head of the Musée Art et Histoire in Geneva, a great guy who really took time to nurture artists. And he was introducing me to a gallery, which was a great introduction, significant introduction as well. The gallerist, who was a former school teacher, looked at my work and he said the following. He said, "You're an extremely good painter. It's very interesting what you do. It's very unique. I have never seen anything like this. It's extremely well done and it's very beautiful." He said, "But it's just too warm." It's like, too warm. I'm like, what am I? Do I need to sort of spend a few hours in the freezer every day?
At first you had these landscapes that are very eerie and they're very nostalgic. There's something clearly very Chinese about them, but I imagine they're not in China.
Well, that's an interesting thing. One of the things that I suppose, my father was Chinese, my mother was English, I grew up in England, later in the United States, I've been in Switzerland for many years. So I'm looking for languages that reach all kinds of people, obviously. I'm a global citizen. That word is a difficult one. I was a global prototype, probably. Anybody that's biracial at the age I was born was in the prototype stage. So I'm interested in, if it's a landscape wherever you're from or whatever culture that you can find something essential, a sense of belonging to it. And what happened to me personally was when I went to Ticino in the Italian part of Switzerland, it looked like the place where my father was born in China, and the lighting, and it looked like the things that I had seen as a child that were Chinese, like wrapping papers, greeting cards from my Chinese relatives who I never met until I was 18. And it had a sense of home to it. And so I felt sort of intrinsically attracted to this landscape in this Italian part of Switzerland because it felt Chinese. And that interested me, this response. I thought, this must happen to a lot of people who are now migrating all over the place, that they will be attracted to certain landscapes that maybe have nothing to do with them, but because of a certain light or shaping of the landscape, they will feel a deep attachment.
So after all, your friend, your young friend from Google, might have captured the logic of your painting, because for you landscape is a sort of utopia or a topos of something to belong.
Well, it's the root of. It's because the root of our physicality.
You're rootless.
It's the root of our physicality, the earth. You're born onto the earth and you're born into a body. And
where were you born?
I was born in Windsor, south of London.
South of London.
Yeah.
Where did you spend your childhood?
My childhood I spent in a little village outside of Windsor.
And
my dad was the only non-English person far and wide in that time.
So the resignation is like like, not having roots is something that is very much into your family.
Yes, it's a migration from way back.
And then you went to America.
Then I went to America when I was 14, to the Midwest, not the place where you usually go, to California or New York. I went to Indiana, which is sort of heart of America. and I went to high school there, and but didn't want to stay. I was missing maybe a sense of tradition.
And from there to Switzerland.
And there to no, from there I went back to London to art school, and then I went to I went to Taiwan first to live and learn Chinese for a year and to meet my family. And then I went to London to art school, and then I went to Switzerland. So trips around.
So this image that we are seeing is, it's a conflation of East and West in a, in an Eastern language.
I think one of the things that, and that's another thing.
You're speaking Chinese there.
I think that yes, that story has been very interesting because. But I told you this story about being too warm. I think after I had been to China for the first time and been to the place where my father was born, the whole side of my Chinese background found a landing strip, and I understood where that part of my culture came from. And it was easier to deal with for me to bring that into my work as well. What was very interesting was suddenly what was not accepted, this kind of warmth or being half Chinese, I grew up with the basis that beauty is something profound and powerful. And I have that in me, I think probably, and this is interesting because people are migrating all over the place, they're raising their children with images of homelands that maybe far away from where they're raising their children. So when my father talked about China, he radiated. He radiated warmth and he radiated longing and excitement. And I could smell and see all these things as a child. And of course, I enjoyed the attention that he gave me when telling me the stories. And so I started to visualize this. But these places didn't really have a reality as such. Mm-hmm. And that gave also was an incentive, probably part of my search, you know, to create certain, to visualize that.
And it's kind of like, because I relate to that as second generation of, third generation of immigrants in Argentina. I mean, we're all immigrants. And, you know, in a way, we inherit a tragic idea of what was left behind, that wasn't even left behind by us, but left behind by the people we love, and we long to. So,
I don't want to. I wouldn't put the word tragic to it. I think that's a foregone conclusion. I think what's interesting is that something gets. There's something when you travel, you take with you.
Well,
what
that image is not comedic.
It's not what?
Comedic. It's more tragic than comedy. There's more tragedy than comedy.
Well,
there's no hero, but I would say if you wanted the hero is that long lost land that actually two things happen to me with these images that we're seeing. It looks like a corpse. And it's something that then I see in many of your images. There's an anthropomorphy, there's a human shape.
There's a human body
at the end. At the end of the day, there's always like the leaves are like, and the branches are like arms and fingers. The landscape is like a body, and you know that valley is not a valley. It's something like a book. Or a body, or it's like I can see the face and I can see the torso of someone. I mean, and
well, you know, the Chinese say when you paint something, you have to be that thing. And I mean, if you're a human, you can't be a camel, obviously. So I'm a human being. So everything I perceive will be the perception of a human being. It won't be the perception of a dog or a cat as long as I'm a human being. So that's my starting point. For example, when I paint a mountain, it's this part of the body that for me is like the back of the mountain, and this sound that it makes. I imagine that if you would be huge and you would embrace a mountain that you'd have this feeling here around the ribcage.
So now I'm thinking of this other image, which is this like close-up, chopped close-up, a very idiosyncratic and very I think it's a very new take on trees. because basically what you're doing with the pictorial space is like you chopped the tree, and the tree becomes, it takes like 8/9, 10/8, 9/9 of the pictorial space. This is the complete inversion of what we know as landscape, as for example Dutch landscape that we are seeing now, and where you have 5/6 of skies. Here is the complete opposite. So there's, we pass from sentencing, we're talking about anthropomorphic things and about the body, what happens here? I mean, this is the blocked body, but there's something that doesn't block here. Actually, it's a kind of like an openness, an opportunity to see something else.
Well, one of the things you mentioned before about the cropping of images, and one of the things I feel is that all the images are part of one big image, and I think that's essentially my inquiry as well. Are there separations between these things? So this has again comes around to the issues around duality. Is there, if I'm painting a landscape, my first question is, when does a mountain stop being a mountain and become sky? And does it stop? You know, what does it mean for one thing to be, what is a boundary? And so all the paintings to me are part of one big image. And that has it's a philosophical and spiritual argument at the end of the day.
There's something in your new works, I'm talking about like your latest works that we're seeing now, is that where this process goes even farther, and it can appear to be a more conceptual drive, where we can see the fragment, but the fragment is almost gone as a fragment. We can see a portion more than a fragment, and we can see another fragment that cannot give you an idea of totality. You know that it's part of something else, but you don't know what that something else is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's a very good observation.
So what's going on with these images? What do you expect from the viewer?
Well, as all the references to all that I paint are lived references. They're not contrived references. So I think I just have to tell a story of how these elements came in, these geometric elements, and I've been painting in this studio in Switzerland where I look onto the lake through the branch of these 150-year-old Himalayan cedar trees that are absolutely amazing, and I've looked at them for hours and hours and hours, and I've internalized them through all sorts of seasons and light. And recently, the garden in front of these cedars that was belonging to the Fontissen family, where there was the Fontissen collection, has been sold, the property, and is being developed by a property developer, and 8 luxury villas are being built, designed by Herzog & de Meuron. It's a building site that's been going on now for over 2 years. And at the beginning, I was crying for the days when they came in and cut the trees, pruned the trees. They dug up the whole garden within a very short amount of time, and started to build the foundation for these villas. And I was troubled. It was, my comfort zone had been heavily intruded upon. But what happened was, I started to get totally intrigued by this process of the building, of the working, of the work, of the becoming of this building, and the daily work of these builders. And it was their daily presence and their daily effort and this small ant work that I could totally associate with also as an artist. I feel that being an artist is a kind of ant work as well. Execution of the work is a slow process, a very physical process, and this most recent triptych is 9 meters of cedar branches with hundreds of needles that have to be worked in and out of and brought to a pitch where the space between the needles and the needles starts to resonate and have an energy and a presence to it, and it takes a long time. And so I watch the builders to build this building, which now the raw skeleton of the building is standing, was numerous buckets of cement going backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards. And I watched the builder executing this, the guy with them operating the crane, this little yellow box around his stomach, and watching this huge cement urn release the cement onto all the iron awnings. And I got so amazed by this human effort, and I started to fall in love with that.
But it's not that much of a human effort.
Well, it was.
It's more the machine
effort. No. That's not like
because
that.
You're describing it as...
Watch a building site every day from the morning till night. There is so much lugging and shoving and hauling of human energy. It's a sort of a a cliche idea that it's all done by machines. It's actually not. I mean, there's somebody there who has to shove in the bucket. Somebody has to yank down the thing that the cement is released, and then yank the machine that it can go off and it can go to the other side of the building site and be released. Somebody has to shove the concrete around with this big flat thing, and then someone else is sucking out the air bubbles. It's this huge physical dynamic. And I started to befriend myself with this human effort in a way that was new. And it took me away from this feeling of perhaps longing for escape from the impact of human activity. And I started to want to consolidate something with that, but not at any price and not in any way. So I'm looking for a way how to unpick the meaning in this human activity.
So how do you maintain yourself out of the system? How do you survive?
Well, as I said, I'm not lazy. All the things I've done, I've generally reached out in my own way to do projects, to finance them. I do events sometimes in my studio. I spend a lot of time, if someone wants to come to the studio, to really invite them. I try to create that in a painting anyway, a sense of invitation for the viewer to enter.
Yeah, but you sold paintings in London. That's not your studio. How did you do that?
Well, I got curious at some point to see, and probably old enough maybe to become a little bit more confident about what I think in my position as an artist better. And I thought, I'd like to see what happens with this in a larger city when exposed to a larger audience and not just Switzerland. And my son suggested I came to London, and I had just received a very good commission for a couple of works in Switzerland, and with this money I took a space and ran my own show. And I did a sit-down dinner in the gallery, I made a big table, I made...
Who did you invite? I mean, how does it work when you are not in the galleries? I mean, you don't have a mailing list.
I did things like research people I thought would be interesting and wrote to them. People also who I just wrote to on the internet, and institutions, galleries, private people, just very freshly and full of a kind of a mixture between naive and very smart enthusiasm, approached people. What I did discover is that, and that was the biggest, my biggest pleasure of the project in London, was that even in this big city, people are really touched by enthusiasm. If you have an idea and you are full of energy and you're willing to give something of yourself, it's quite contagious. And the response to that, what, even in this big city where there's so much going on, and I don't pretend to be anything, I don't know God way out from where, but I certainly got amazing support. From surprisingly also established institutions that were just like, I like her energy. She's working. She's doing something. She's not complaining. She's...
But how do you manage? How do you manage not to? Because I mean, it's, I'm listening to you, and it's like, wow, how does she? Because I'm in kind of like same dilemma with my writing, and the I cannot. I just cannot do the commercial thing.
Let me tell you a story.
No, but let me. So, how do you manage not to become a caricature of yourself? How do you manage not to become the enthusiastic artist that comes from Switzerland?
Because
and work as an enthusiastic artist.
Because I have a place where, you know, I've been painting on myself for so long, and I know my own ropes in a way that when I'm in my studio, there's nobody there, neither London nor anybody. And then it's hard work, and I suffer too, because sometimes things are happening that I don't expect, like in some of this recent work around the red cement urn, the building site series, things have emerged with these new geometric shapes between the cedars that were difficult for me to accept. It was something that happened in front of my eyes, in front of my studio, that I felt I had to paint. And but the paintings that emerged were not easy for me to accept initially, and I felt totally insecure about it at the beginning. So those moments in the studio, I am completely reduced to knowing nothing and groveling. As ever.
Yeah, because it changed your way, even your way of moving in front of the canvas, because it's like you passed from an almost rhythmic mantra, rhythm of love, kind of like paintings this, leaf by leaf and needle by needle in your cedars, to painting block geometric blocks. So you became, in a way, there's transition between the warmth of the expression and a certain masculinity that appeared, or a certain, like, the geometry is always very much linked to masculinity. So there's something, even you, when you talked about it from the point of view of, like, builders and of, like, and chunks and blocks, and it's the opposite of the nature, of the feminine. So what's going on there?
Well, one of the situations that I was born into is that I'm biracial, and I also grew up with, I had two brothers, a handicapped brother and a normal brother. So I'm a fully fledged painter. I've been painting every day all my life. With before and after and throughout having children. At the same time, I didn't just have one child to sort of experiment. I had three, which was kind of a decision that I really wanted to also dig in there. So I'm interested in duality. And
because I'm thinking of your, what I would call your Sistine Chapel effort. You know, this Manet-like, huge mural-sized branches, which are very interesting because they negotiate the space between themselves in a very, I mean, they remind me a lot in the way they touch, the main branches touch one another, and they remind me a lot to Sistine Chapel, to the creation of Adam by Michelangelo, you know, that when God creates Adam by touching with, you know, the other two fingers, that kind of like topos of the history of art. But at the same time, there's something else that happens in these images, and I think I'm thinking of these branch on the right that is almost breaking on the viewer's face. So it's a negotiation also. It's breaking itself, showing the viewer its own insides. There's something three-dimensional going in a very two-dimensional painting. And I believe that this is the moment where you start thematizing these intermediate spaces. The intermediate is not what it's supposed to be. The intermediate is a moment of weakness here. While in this painting, the intermediate is discussed at a different level, at a visual level. What's happening with the image and you?
I'd like to say something, Rodrigo, and this has to do with our conversation, and I hope that in this dialogue we're having now that it doesn't get stuck in the sort of obvious assumption that it's just a private conversation, because I really don't think it is, and I'd like to underline that. But certainly what happened, the impact of our conversation initially was that I am not alone with certain considerations and deep desires in terms of communication through painting to reach people on a human level. I suddenly felt it's not just something I do in my own space. And then there are some people that love that and buy that, and whether it's somebody corporate or somebody private or whatever. But somewhere I realized, and I knew it, but I didn't quite dare maybe to really take a hold of it. And I know that taking a hold or taking a hold of this and say, and sort of standing for that, has to do with this triptychon. And that has to do with our conversation.
What do you mean?
Well, I think that it was an unleashing of something and putting it into the open to say, this is something that makes sense to me, but it's been private before. And suddenly I realized, oh my God, this goes beyond being private. How silly of me to keep this private. What's this thing about being private? And so I think that feeling of unleashedness and these meeting points and affinities and discord, this orchestration of something. I thought a lot of an orchestral sound when I was doing these paintings. Mm-hmm. And sound coming from very far behind me. I mean, this is nothing new in our conversation. It's coming from far back, probably before we ever met. So in terms of thought, the things we're talking about, in terms of thinking about. So suddenly, it's like an airplane that found a landing strip. And the motivation that gave me was great and exciting.
Why haven't you? Because I mean, well, you were talking about like the public and the private, and this image. I mean, it's by definition public by its size, by the power of its size itself. It's competing with, you know, with the big tradition of abstract expressionism and making gigantic paintings, and it's competing with muralism. So my question is, there's something ornamental about your images that also discusses, negotiates its place with the private. I mean, I'm thinking about the private as small painting, as feminine, as letters, as you know, as weaving, as things that are as are for the private space. And these are images, but they're still, in spite of their size, these are still paintings. These are not murals. So why haven't you delved into that kind of decoration of, like, you know, decorating a villa, or the, is like the, as so many before you did, and you stick to the easel painting. What is it with the easel painting and you?
I think I want to go back first to what you said about the private and the public and the feminine aspect and the detail, the private aspect and the public aspect owing to the size and the dimension of these paintings. I mean, basically one of the things that for me is essential in something I experience and is that when you stand from afar, that you get an, you receive the impact of an image, whatever it is. It can be a cow in a field. But if you do see a cow in the field and you walk up to that cow and you start to look at its eyelashes, or you look at its fur or the folds around its feet, skin, you will discover and keep discovering and keep discovering. And that's when you know something is really there. You get closer and closer and it's still there. And that's for me essential. That's what I try to do. It's my way of saying, hey, I'm here, to try to give that kind of energy that when from afar you see something and you get closer and closer and closer and it's still there. So the details in these paintings, if you paint it, if you walk very close up, they'll still feed you.
And it's funny that you say that, because it's true, because your paintings deal with the tension between the telescopic and the microscopic.
Yeah.
It's you play with, because if you go farther into, you become microscopic. You will see the cells.
But as I said, Rodrigo, that's why I consider my work actually is conceptual. But I, as I mentioned in what my first reading, is that conceptuality shouldn't just be a representation. You know, the concept is the beginning. It's a starting point, and shouldn't be the end point. And so, I don't think it's that I'm making some huge, great discovery, but if I just take the act of seeing, not at all. But if you take the
act of... This is the concetto for the Italian
Renaissance. If you go and simply look at something and you get closer and closer, and I think that's something that very often, that's the problem with our seeing experience today, that when you look closely, suddenly the things stop.
Or you might see blood. So I want to go to this image. Because what I'm discovering now talking to you is that the pictorial surface for you works kind of like a skin that you carry on painting that skin and enticing the viewer that it's something beyond. But you never show it. It's because it's the skin, and the skin covers. The skin stops. But what's happening with these images? I mean, because when you include a color, you include this very symptomatic Bordeaux, which is, I mean, if we understand that blood is the when someone has nothing else to paint with, the only thing that you can paint with is with your own blood. So, you this is a very primal color, and you keep putting it. And in this image that we're seeing now, it becomes, it's kind of like you took the skin from the surface and you're showing us that. What happens in this image?
You're digging deep. Since ever, I generally get an inkling of what I'm going to be doing maybe 10 years beforehand. And I remember a number of years, quite many years, when I was started painting landscapes, and I had the feeling I could truly open myself up to looking at a mountain or looking at a tree with every piece of me, that I could be open to listen to it and internalize it and take it close to me. And that's what I do when I'm painting something. to try to really to look at that fully. What does it mean to look at something fully? It has to do with realizing how temporary you are, because what you see is going to be gone in a moment, and you're going to be gone a few moments later. I mean, it has to do with our human condition of temporality. You know,
maybe that's why in this painting there is no beginning and no end.
Okay, so one of the things I mentioned when I started to feel a certain trust, you know, painting mountains, painting plants, and I think and I remember saying, one day I hope I can go to the city maybe and look at human things with the same willingness to be open and to engage without, you know, on that same level of awareness of one's own temporality. And I think that's what I saw in the builders. It was a reflection of something I do myself in the studio.
It is because they cannot look at back at you?
Well, they did. They became aware of me, and they came to visit. This was quite an amazing thing. These builders that would come to the studio, and I showed them some of the pictures, and they liked them. They liked them very much. And I think they liked them because I was interested in their work, simply. So they were interested to communicate. And this is the crux of my position, how I approach art and also painting. So back to this red. Now, red is the color of blood, so it has to do with the engagement with the human on a physical level as well here in this red. This is a very physical red.
Think about this painting. It's their paintings, they're paintings of they create a state of being. They don't have a narrative. They don't have a beginning or an end. They are abstract. And this one, I find it very interesting at the level of the surfaces. What you manage to do with the skin, because the skin and the surface of the construction becomes, in a way, that image that we saw before, becomes this state of being. That builder is not supposed. There's something of an insect in that builder. If you want, is my point. You got to a point in your. This is what I find very interesting in your new work, that you're really challenging the difference between the inside and the outside of the body and of reality and of the painting experience. It's in a way, it's a step in a different direction than what you were doing before, because in what you're doing before, you were discussing the two dimensions, and here you are turning that human thing into a complete different thing. We are insects. We are part of something that transcends us. And I think that for you, art is that should indicate where the lack of boundaries start. In a way, art as a place is a place where that discussion takes place, the limit between the inside and the outside.
Totally, totally. And if this conversation doesn't find breath in art, where are you going to have it?
About this image.
Okay, I'm, you know, this was a very difficult painting.
Because I see a baby and a coffin. it's like the circle of life.
I mean, this was, you can imagine, coming, you know, watching the you know, I've been painting for a long time, so the paintings have sort of got a life of their own in the meantime, and I use the paint extremely lightly. I don't correct. So I built the paintings, and just like watching a construction site, if they poured a huge cement wall, it's very difficult to take it down again. A lot of times, a decision's made and then it's there. And that's the process in which I paint as well. So this painting is one of it's the one figure in this series, and he's a sort of archetypal builder that's driven by his building, the drive in him to build. And I mean, it's a bit of a child's drawing in a way, you know. It's he wears a helmet to try to protect himself, that he's pushing this thing, and so it's a reference to a Sisyphus image. It's what I chose very carefully is that you don't know what he's thinking, you don't see his face, and you don't see what's in the bucket. And that's where I break the narrative aspect. And I do that very often by eliminating certain points where you would really give the story away. It takes it into the abstract. So you're totally right that the paintings are abstract.
Is he going to go into the bucket? My impression is that there's something very like life as such. And I'm thinking of like the Clarice Lispector.
Yeah. I read her.
Oh, I'm thinking of that. I'm thinking of, it's interesting that you read about her, because I keep thinking of your generation, your place in life. I mean, this kind of art as Clarice Lispector's literature cannot come from a 20-year-old girl or boy. It has to come from a woman that has given birth and dealt with the whole inside and outside of the body in a very deep and vital way. I mean, there's no other way. And what I see is that the market is kind of like pushing, the art market is pushing to commodified images of womanhood and femininity that actually are girly. I'm thinking about Beatrice Milliage. I'm thinking about that. And you are doing something that is, in a way, is anthropophagic in a Brazilian way. I'm thinking of Lydia Clark now at MoMA. This idea of the viewer or the spectator as participant in a process that changes the object of art itself. And in a way, this image says it all, because he is building the whole, he is building a thing made of blood that can contain him. And so I wonder whether this is an allegory of you and art,
you know,
because art is your own uterus and your own coffin.
You've touched a lot of things in the last thing you've said, but one of the things for me, the creative process, one of my references, creative process, in its purest sense, does have to do with the fact that I've had three children and delivered three times. And you don't go through that kind of experience. It is an experience that is, to give birth. As an artist, that had impact, great impact.
And as a woman, I mean, I'm thinking of this image, because there's something very uterus about
one
this.
One of the things that I intrinsically knew, I remember the first time I delivered to my first daughter, was that what I deliver does not belong to me. It's not mine.
Pensar en ella se esconde y destroza porciones de la torre de nociones. fantasmas eran míos.